So next talk is by Louis Welch on the stochastic enrichment of near pristine systems, POP2 stars versus the most metal poor damp Lyapunov absorbers.
Great. So hi, everyone. Yes, my name is Louise, and I'm a PhD student at Durham University. And so today I'll talk about the chemical enrichment of some near pristine systems, focusing on trying to search for the chemical signature of population 3 stars in a sample of metal poor Milky Way halo stars. And just for some motivation, or so how we do this, we have to kind of understand the expected chemistry of these massive metal-free stars. So we can look to simulations of the evolution and explosion of massive metal-free stars to get an idea of the chemical yields that we'd expect for a range of different stellar properties. And so I've been using the simulations from Hager and Woosley, performed in 2010, and they calculate the yields of population 3 supernovae as a function of the progenitor star mass, the explosion energy of the supernovae, and also the degree of mixing between the different stellar layers. So in this figure, I'm just showing the magnesium to calcium and nickel to iron abundance that you would expect for a range of different stellar properties. So the panels in blue correspond to when we have a nominal mixing between the different stellar layers. And this corresponds to a mixing width that's around 10% of the helium core size. And then the yields that I'm showing in orange correspond to the case when the mixing between the stellar layers is more minimal, so it's around 1% of the helium core size. And the different colored lines here are corresponding to different energy explosions, where as you go to lighter lines, you get progressively higher energy explosions. So the key takeaway from this figure is that if you have a system that has been enriched by one population 3 supernovae, then if we know the detailed chemistry of that system, we can work back to find the properties of the population 3 star that's enriched it. But as we've heard from talks by Gen Chiaki earlier, it's possible that these surviving relic objects may have been enriched by multiple progenitors. So something that's useful to do is construct this stochastic chemical enrichment model, where we're trying to gauge the number of massive population 3 stars that have chemically contributed to a given system. And so here I'm showing the model that I've been working with, where the stars are forming obeying an underlying mass distribution that's governed by a power law, and the slope is given by this parameter alpha, and the stars are forming between a given minimum and maximum mass. And in addition to the mass distribution of these enriching stars, we're also trying to gauge the energy of the supernova explosion and also the mixing between the different stellar layers. And the key benefit to a model like this is that because we expect the metal-free stars to form individually or in small multiples, your underlying IMF is going to be stochastically sampled. And that means that the observed distribution of abundances, like magnesium to calcium, that you would expect to see across these relic objects will change depending on the average number of stars chemically contributing to each system. So you can see in this figure here that as your objects are being enriched by more and more stars, this distribution of magnesium to calcium is getting more and more centrally concentrated. So using this model, I've tried to look at the chemical enrichment of a sample of metal poor halo stars, whose iron to hydrogen abundances are all less than -2.5. So they're at least 300 times more iron poor than the sun. And the stars that I've been using come from four historic surveys. So there are two samples from the first stars series and also two more recent surveys from David Young and Ian Roederer. And in my analysis, I chose to look at the relative abundances of magnesium to calcium and nickel to iron of these stars. So here I'm showing you the abundance distribution of these elements for the four different samples. And you can see that they're broadly consistent with one another, but there is a small offset in the magnesium to calcium abundances between the data from the 2014 sample and that of the other samples. And it turns out that this, while this offset is very small, it's only around 0.1 dex, it does have an impact on the enrichment model parameters that we estimate. So it's actually been very useful for testing the sensitivity of our model to the input data. But for now, I just wanted to highlight the results that we found when looking at the three samples compiled before 2014. So here I'm showing the estimated enrichment model parameters for these three samples. And we found in general that these stars were preferentially enriched by minimally mixed hypernovae, but the key parameter that I wanted to talk about today is the number of enriching stars that we find. So if we just zoom in here to the region that occupies the one sigma confidence region of our parameter estimate, you can see that we found around 5 massive population 3 stars seem to have chemically contributed to the sample of metal-poor halo stars used in our analysis. And this is quite interesting, I think, given Tillman's talk earlier in his plot with his work with Michal Ishigaki. It seems like we're finding similar numbers of enriching stars for these stellar relics. So that should be quite cool. But one thing that you may be asking is how well can this model actually replicate the data? So here I'm showing the magnesium to calcium abundance and the nickel to iron abundance that you would expect given our inferred enrichment model. And overplotted on that density contour is our stellar data coming from the three samples prior to 2014. And you can see from this figure that the model and the data are broadly consistent with one another, but there is still this small offset between magnesium to calcium. And so improvements can still be made. And some recent work by Rana Ezzedine suggests that non-LTE corrections to magnesium to calcium may bring our model and data into better agreement with one another. And another thing to be aware of is the idea that if we perform these simulations of stellar evolution in 3 dimensions, it might also influence the fit between our model and the data. And another thing that I thought was quite interesting to do with this work was to look at the chemical enrichment of low mass structures in the early universe. So prior to this, I've really been looking at the chemistry of near pristine gas, thank you, in the early universe. So these metal poor DLAs. And in some previous analysis, I estimated the number of enriching stars for these systems. And so by comparing the number of enriching stars across the metal poor DLAs and this analysis of metal poor stars, under the assumption that the number of stars enriching a typical metal poor halo star is comparable to the population 3 multiplicity, then we can start to infer the number of population 3 mini halos that have chemically contributed to the low mass structures at a redshift of 3. So here I'm just showing the posterior distribution of this parameter N halos, and you can see by the gray dashed line that our 2 sigma upper confidence limit suggests that less than 13 population 3 mini halos may have chemically contributed to the metal poor DLAs I analyzed last year. And finally, I wanted to briefly highlight some more recent work we've been doing using the carbon isotope ratio that I think fits in quite nicely with the next talk coming up. So here I'm showing the carbon 12 to carbon 13 ratio as a function of progenitor mass that you would expect for a range of different stellar populations. And you can see that the only way to produce low amounts of carbon 12 to carbon 13 is through the low mass population 3 stars shown in purple, or the intermediate mass population 2 stars shown in gray. So the idea here is that if we can detect this carbon isotope ratio in a near pristine system, we may be able to detect the presence or absence of low mass population 3 stars. And so recently, using ESPRESSO, we have placed the first bound on this carbon isotope ratio in a near pristine DLA. And we could rule out the presence of large amounts of carbon 13, but we couldn't empirically rule out enrichment from low mass population 3 stars with the current data. And that brings me on to my conclusions, which are that early stellar populations that can be investigated using the surviving chemical signature left behind by their core collapse supernovae. And this enrichment model takes into account the stochastic nature of the population 3 IMF. The most metal poor stars appear to have been minimally enriched by massive population 3 stars. And the combined analysis of these stars and the most metal poor DLAs may offer a way to look at the number of population 3 mini halos that contribute to a low mass structure at a redshift of 3. And finally, we've recovered the first bound on this carbon isotope ratio in a near pristine system. And with future data, we are hopeful that we may be able to rule out enrichment from low mass population 3 stars. So, thank you.
Oh, thank you, Louise, for a wonderful talk. Very interesting. We do have several questions. Let me read out one from someone who hasn't yet asked the question. So Asas Kuladottir says, very nice talk. Do you see any correlation between FE over age and the number of enriching stars?
Something age and the enriching stars?
Do you see any correlation between the iron to hydrogen ratio and the number of enriching stars?
That's interesting.
Metal poor halo stars.
Yes. So I think something that we should do definitely is look at even lower metallicity stars. So with a cutoff of iron to hydrogen of -3 and below, and see if the number of enriching stars does go down. I don't have any solid evidence to say on that yet, but it is something that we want to look into. And I'm hopeful that there would be a correlation, but of course, yeah, I don't know.
Okay, so another question is, have you thought about doing this analysis with dwarf metal poor stars in dwarf spheroidals?
Yes, we would love to do that. But the problem, I think, if I remember rightly, is that there aren't that many stars in these systems that we can use. Yeah, I think that was the main impediment. So Segway 1 was one of the places that we tried to conduct this, but I'm not sure on the numbers. But yeah, I think we were limited by low number statistics, especially looking at an individual dwarf. Yeah.
Okay, here's one more quick one. What is the mass of the halos that pollute the DLAs?
The mass of the DLA, the halos that pollute the DLAs, that's a good question. But the general idea is that when we're modeling the enrichment of the DLAs, we assume that the stars have come from multiple population 3 mini halos. So presumably more than one 10 to the 6 mini halo. And then however many, these DLAs are likely hosted in some of the lowest mass structures at that redshift interval.
Okay, last quick one is awesome. Alex G asks, awesome, Louis. I'm wondering if you redid this using POP2 instead of POP3 yields.
Yeah.
It does differ.
That's a good question. I don't know. There are all so many good questions. I don't know the answer to that.
More, by the way. So, yeah, you're encouraged to go to Slack as well. There's more questions there.
Okay. My brief answer is I don't know. Certainly for other elements like carbon and oxygen, you have very similar yields for population 3 and population 2 stars. So it would be unlikely to make a difference in that case. But for these elements, I haven't checked, so I don't know if that's the same